call the BO board meeting to order of April 28, 2015. We all will please join me in a moment of reflection.
Thank you. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I couldn't find the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic which stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. At this time, I'd like to start off with roll call. I'd like to welcome all of you to our board meeting, and thanks certainly our riders for taking the time to be here and share your thoughts and your comments with us. And to all our staff, thank you for the great job that you do each and every day. As I am out in the community, I hear great things about the great work that you all do, and so I have to tell you how proud I am of all of you and proud to be part of the VIA family. So with that, I'll start roll call. Trustee Cedillo.
Here. Welcome, everyone.
Trustee Marn.
Here.
Trustee Ponick.
Here.
Trustee Gambita.
Here.
Trustee Morgan.
Here.
Trustee Bryant.
Here.
Trustee Thompson is running late, and Secretary Harrison is also running late. Vice Chair Allison.
Here.
Great. And I'm Hope Andrade, and I'm also present. So, Jeff, announcements. Okay.
Excellent. All right, well, I have a number of announcements. Things have been going on lately in the month of April. So the first is that April is National Poetry Month, and so throughout this month, our buses and vans have been adorned with winning illustrated poems from Poetry on the Move contest. I think each of you have a little booklet that show you those poems. It's an annual contest. It's open to anyone over the age of 18 in Central and South Texas, and the winning poems are illustrated, printed, and distributed as interior cards throughout our entire fleet. This year we had 12 winning poems in VIA's contest, and then another 10 were accepted from the San Antonio Public Library's Young Pegasus program. All 22 were sent to 4 area art schools where they were illustrated before being printed on these interior cards. To kick off National Poetry Month, we held a media event and poetry reading featuring the participating poets, and we're very grateful to our Community Relations Coordinator, Jerry Ann Jones, for her outstanding work. Jerry Ann, stand up, please, so we can acknowledge you. Thank you, Jerry Ann. We've had a number of special events very recently. On the 15th of April, the Alamo Dome played host to one of the premier soccer matchups in the region when the U.S. men's team took on Mexico's team, and VIA provided special event park and ride service to the Alamo Dome from AT&T Center. We carried about 8,500 passengers that evening. In fact, our service was greatly appreciated, and I have in front of each of you a copy of a letter that I'd like to just put in the record. Dear Mr. Art, I would like to take this opportunity to thank you and your staff for the excellent job they performed for the men's U.S. versus Mexico soccer match on April 15th, 2015. The magnitude of this event was tremendous, not only for the Alamo Dome, but for the city of San Antonio. We truly faced some momentous challenges with parking, traffic, and construction issues, to name a few, but VIA Park and Ride Services transported our patrons to and from the Alamo Dome efficiently and effectively. I commend all of your employees for their dedication and hard work, which made this event a huge success. And this is from Nicholas A. Langella, who is the general manager at the Alamo Dome. So that's fantastic. And then it was followed up just after that with our biggest special event movement of the year, and that is the services associated with the various events around Fiesta. We carried about 24,500 Fiesta goers and could not have done so without the enthusiastic efforts of our special event staff and our bus supervisors. So I'd like to, first of all, thank all of them, congratulate all of you for your great success, acknowledge the manager of bus transportation, Michael Ledesma, and all the supervisors and special event staff. If you'd stand up in the audience so we can acknowledge you. That to run those kinds of services night after night after night successfully is just a lot of hard work. And yesterday at the MPO, they remarked that, Monday after Fiesta is called Fiesta Hangover Day. I did not know that. And I said, well, our staff has a different kind of hangover. It's just exhaustion from a job well done. Thank you all so much. Thank you, Michael.
Jeff, if I may interrupt you, I have to tell you that I personally use Park and Ride during the evening of the U.S.-Mexico soccer game. And I had not used Park and Ride in a couple of years, but I have to tell you that I was so impressed with how organized, how friendly, happy everyone was, and it was so busy. But yet they guided us to the right line. They weren't, you know, people were asking questions. Everyone was smiling. And so I congratulate you. I believe that this is reflective of your great leadership. But I was just so proud to see everyone so happy and in such, being so cooperative with everyone, because we had a lot of people from outside the country. And yet everyone, you know, you didn't seem to be bothered by all the questions that were being asked. So I was just walking around so proud. I had a smile from just ear to ear, and I want to say, I'm part of that. I'm part of that because I was so proud to be part of that. So thank you all very much.
Thank you all
so
much.
You did a great job.
And, you know, our service to the community does not stop when the shift ends, if you will. So I would like to recognize, special recognition to Supervisor Jose Hinojosa. Jose, where are you? Stand up. So, let me tell you what for. Supervisor Hinojosa witnessed a three vehicle accident on I-37 in which one vehicle ended up on its side. Our supervisor immediately stopped the patrol truck he was driving, activated his service lights to warn other motorists, closing the fast lane of traffic in the process. He checked on the condition of the motorists involved, including the one whose vehicle was overturned, obviously, talking with them, calming them until emergency responders arrive. And so that just indicates, you know, the true dedication for safety to the entire community, whether on the bus or in the community. And so thank you for representing us so well. Now, this weekend, we will be represented by our maintenance team and our operator at the International Bus Rodeo. It's in Fort Worth this year, so we won't have to travel as far. As I've told our team, the maintenance team has won 3 of the last 4 years, correct? 3 of the last 4 years. So I said, I don't want to put any extra pressure on you. Just do your very best and make sure it's 4 of the last 5. And so we'll look forward to presenting them to you next month with those results. On the administrative side, pleased to announce that VIA has received the Distinguished Budget Presentation Award from the Government Finance Officers Association, and this award is the highest form of recognition in governmental budgeting and reflects the commitment of VIA to meeting the highest principles of governmental budgeting. In order to receive this award, VIA had to satisfy nationally recognized guidelines for effective budget presentation, which assess how well an entity's budget serves as a policy document, a financial plan, an operations guide, and a communications device. VIA rated proficient in all 4 of those categories, and so we're grateful to our manager of budget and grants, Richard Betts. Richard, are you here? There you go, Richard. Thank you. And Steve Lange, our vice president for finance. All right. Just in time for Earth Day, VIA was honored by the Alamo Area Council of Governments with an Air Quality Stewardship Award. This award was given to VIA for our efforts to preserve demand response public transportation services in remoter areas in the northeast side of San Antonio and the region. Following the 2010 census, the cities of New Braunfels, Schertz, Cibolo, Garden Ridge, and McQueenie ended up included in the San Antonio urbanized area. They were formerly rural areas and had transportation provided through state and federal rural transportation funds. They were no longer eligible for those funds, but our board stood up and worked with them to partner to continue those services. And so we were recognized by ACOG for that effort to maintain those services and our focus on air quality stewardship. And I did announce at that time that we, in fact, are moving forward, and we'll be briefing the board next month on buying new buses, CNG-powered buses, which is another step toward air quality stewardship. And lastly, and just in time for this, we have been running the e-service, as you know, since March 28th, and we were able to enter the e-trolley as a float in the King William Parade and Fair last Saturday. Estimated attendance at this community event were upwards of 75,000 people. We had about a dozen V employees, their family, and Mr. Harrison and his family were leading the parade. You saw, Mark, we had pictures of you before you arrived that we were showing to the crowd, including the one where I believe the sheriff was trying to control your behavior.
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Yes, he was. We enjoyed it immensely, and my family, you know, I like to see my children, I like to show them what I do. So my children were very happy that they were in a parade, and I was too, to, you know, make sure that we're a part of the community as a whole, you know.
And so I think as we discussed before, this is a real opportunity for outreach as well, and the King William Fair really, the attempt of the King William Fair people is to avoid litter, and so you don't have handouts necessarily, but what we did is we took our information and put it on a hand fan, and we went along the route and handed them out, and they were greatly appreciated by the people, because you know Saturday, once the rain parted, it got plenty hot, plenty quick. And so people got information about our 2040 planning effort through their hand fan, and that was a really great way to do that. I want to express my appreciation to Lauren Sanchu, who's the executive assistant to the chief of staff, and to Christine Vigneau, who really worked to get us in the parade against a lot of odds, I believe. And so if they're here, if they'd stand up and be recognized. Lauren, I know Lauren is here. Thank you. And there's Christine. Thank you both so much. I had a great time, too. And that is my report.
Thank you. Great report. We'll move on to citizens to be heard.
Madam Chairwoman, we have 8 citizens to be heard tonight. As your name is called, you're welcome to come to the front to make your comments. If you'd like to speak from where you sit, please raise your hand as your name is called, and a microphone will be brought to you. The first citizen is Larry Rosen.
My name is Larry Roser, and I'm a ViaTrans user, and I want to talk briefly about an experience I had on the 18th on a Saturday night. I was picked up from my home address on Woodchase to go to Milano's Cafe, an Italian restaurant with a taxi service. Going there was a little bit of an ordeal, but it wasn't terrible. I only had to wait 40 minutes. And my second call, after the first call, a taxi came and took me to the restaurant. And that was good, because when I made my reservation for the taxi, I asked for a round trip. Going home was a little bit of a problem. After my meal was over, I called once. And when I called to find out where my ride was after 20 minutes, they put me to the line that says, talk to a dispatcher. Well, the phone rang and rang and rang, but no dispatcher ever picked up the phone. So I called back again, and they said, call back in 20 minutes. I called back another 20 minutes, and the phone rang and rang and rang. No dispatcher answered the phone. So I called back, and they said, call back in 10 minutes. I called back after 50 minutes of waiting, and so the dispatcher said, well, your ride will be here shortly. Well, I waited about 5 or 10 more minutes, and ride didn't come. So finally, a family member came and took me home. Now, I realize that the system is not perfect, and I know that Saturday nights can be a problem trying to get a ride because of all the drivers that are out there. But one improvement that could be made into the system is where you call and a dispatcher answers the phone, but they can't call back instead of putting us to a dispatcher that doesn't answer the phone. Have someone tell us your ride's on the list, and that's all I have to say.
Barbara Stockford.
Hello, can you hear me? My name is Barbara Stockford. I am here to commend Star Shuttle. I've used their service now for a little over 10 years, along with VIA and other ones. But My opinion is that we have entered with them with a, to do sensitivity training, and I think that's a benefit. And I noticed that the drivers seem to be more attentive to the needs of just not visually impaired, but handicapped altogether. And I think that's a plus. Star Shuttle picks up, as you know, many of the slacks that VIA can't get to, or an area where the bigger buses can't ride or get into the buildings areas. And I really appreciate their service. I appreciate VIA Trans, because without you, we would not have transportation. So it's a win-win situation for the both of us. We get out to go where we need to go without feeling to bother a family member, and VIA allows us to do that, and so does Star Shuttle, and I want to thank you for that service.
Thank you.
And as always, there's always room for improvement, but I want to say thank you. Star Shuttle has done a great job, and so have you.
Thank you very much.
Shelley McMullen.
Good evening. I will be brief, and I just want to say that, like, the comments that we just heard were very positive, but it's been my observance over the years, and I've been coming to these meetings for quite some time now, I've observed that there are some people that get up to speak, and we certainly all have the right to complain, but it concerns me that there are some people who, whenever they speak, it's always gripe, gripe, gripe. It's total negativity. And I know that sometimes when we only have negative things to say, the people who are listening tend to tune us out because they get tired of hearing all the negativity. And we do, there always is room for improvement. But look at it this way. We take so much for granted. There are so many places where you could live where there is no bus service, there is no paratransit. So we need to be thankful for what we have. And we know that because of things that have happened in the past, that the board and everyone does work well with us when we conduct ourselves appropriately. So before you go to make a presentation, my advice to you would be, start out with something positive if you can. You'll get their attention that way. And you know the saying about the honey and vinegar? Well, the sour bitterness of vinegar, you're not going to accomplish as much with that as you will by the sweetness of the honey. And I just want to say that I too appreciate VIA Trans and Star Shuttle as well. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Damon Mason.
Chairman Andrade, President Arch, VIA Trustees, me, say, this is our Dan Mason. Yes, Dan, tell you, it's one heck of an annual event, all the way back to my first one back in 2002. Back then, I thought it was crazy, Dan, tell you, all of a sudden, throw such a big party for no reason. Now, I've come to realize it just would not feel right if it were late April with no fiesta. Still, the one thing that helped me enjoy this big citywide party, there were no alcohol being sold. I clearly understand the people that are responsible drinkers. Still, the few that are not cause a lot of cloud damage for their challenge to capture it, even if there is no motor vehicle involved. Anyway, let's get to the feature presentation. The first order of business is the over-glorified Caltrain that has behaved toward the motor coach for the Texas Loop 345 BRT service route. Even that tested by Altona Bus Testing and Research Center, I'm not feeling very confident about our CND articulated motor coach. Please exercise greater care about M-Tor acquiring mainline vehicles in the future. Insist upon diesel electric propulsion. Insist upon a compression engine power plant with a potent score of at least 300 horsepower. Insist on the motor to be taught not to jostle the passengers around. One thing that drives it bad is all the noise the compression engine power plant makes when it is idling. In addition to the mechanic telling the power plant to be quiet, investigate if there's some kind of noise canceling that can be added. Another order of business along these lines is to again insist that VIA retire from active service and send to the junkyard each and every motor coach built by North American Bus Industries, starting with the diesel buses. I insist that VIA practice a heavy dose of care about M-Tor for the near and distant future when purchasing mainline and paratransit vehicles. I rode northbound 8, eastbound 21, and eastbound 17 on the 6th of April, the 8th of April, the 9th of April. And one thing is that I found that the ride on the eastbound 17 to Randolph Parker route has the fastest travel time of the three. Unfortunately, it's the only one where I wound up having to cool my heels for another bus to arrive at Randolph Parker ride because of Interstate 35 being popular. Your vision of Smartway SA, the Smartway SA to the 2035 plan and the vision to the 2040 long range plan sounds quite ambitious. Still, when I see things like an Orange Express service driver whose late arrival at the terminus forces you to wait almost an hour, which is enough to get some people fired from their jobs, and the clockwork capitulation of the thick wallets along with the continuous behavior toward your passengers when they petition you for redress, I find it hard to believe that you're being smart, that you have any vision. Want to prove me wrong? They interject some dead air in eastbound Route 17, so they arrive at Randolph Parker right where all of the other buses are already gathered there instead of just after they have left. As you can imagine, your response to what I advised you about Texas Loop 13 is by far the main course. I can see that you realize the reliability and on-time performance is the whole rationale behind why I'm arguing for the installation of exclusive translators in the middle of Texas Loop 13, which I commend you for. Just remember to have the transit coach run in them facing toward the private road traffic, so it appears as dangerous as a large sleeping crocodile or a charging rhinoceros, which most of us would instinctively give a wide berth. Do not think you're going to escape my proof simply because I said that. Fia, do you think a little tweak here and a little tweak there is enough to solve the problem there being far too many cars on the road? You've been in this transit signal prioritization along take a look 345 as part of the BRT service stop. Point out to me where I can demonstrably see it in action. You also mentioned you set up a small scale version of those. Those for the Texas Loop 345 BRT service stop. Via, I take deep irony at the arrogant delusion that overglory at bus stops are enough persuasion for me to see past the clumsy mainline transit service. Learn some humility. Face reality head on. You know these motors get impatient and leap out in front of an approaching mainline motor coach that heat to the back and has a mass of 30,000 pounds, 60,000 pounds in the case of CRG articulated motor coach, and thus cannot easily be brought to a halt. Given that the air brakes do not quickly engage the hydraulic brakes when they are applied, it should not require much computation to realize the significant safety implications of the urban mainline transit service and mixed road traffic speeds slower 50 miles per hour. I'm well of the admonition not to throw the baby out with the bathwater. Still, there are times when ignoring this counsel is the only responsibly effective and possible solution. I do believe the Texas Loop 13 is a good place to apply the lesson as any. In order to do that, we need to start from scratch, galvanize the emphatic commission that 21 feet, 20 miles, 2.1.
Donna McBee.
Thank you.
Hey, Ms. McBee, do you want to speak from where you're sitting?
That's fine.
Here's the
microphone. That's fine, thank you. Via Board of Directors, I'm here on behalf of Alamo Council of the Blind and Four Star Shuttle and Via. Like everyone else, we couldn't do without either one of them. And I understand that Star Shuttle's coming up for a vote on the extension of their contract. I wholeheartedly hope you will give them that endorsement. I think that Mr. Walker has been very gracious in allowing the Alamo Council to allow us to participate in some of their training, to give the drivers firsthand information on the blind and visually impaired and what is working for us. They are eager, and they always come away with a lot of comments, and we appreciate that. So again, thank you for your special service. We need it, we love it. Don't let it go. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Larry Johnson.
No, that's, I don't want the mouse, right? Okay. Good evening, Chair Andrade and board members. My name is Larry Johnson. 2 months ago, I spoke to this board and proposed that VIA might celebrate the 25th anniversary of the Americans with Disabilities Act by setting the goal of becoming a model employer of persons with disabilities in Bexar County. And in response, I received a very polite, non-committal letter from the Director of Customer Service. So I decided that perhaps I needed to come back to this board and be maybe more specific and more helpful. And so what I've provided you with there is an outline of a few ideas or suggestions of how VIA might give special focus to modifying its HR policies and procedures to enhance job opportunities for persons with disabilities. Now, let me clarify. I am not criticizing the current HR policies or procedures, nor the commitment of the CEO and President, Mr. Arndt. I am simply offering some ideas and thoughts of ways in which you might clearly demonstrate and to the community and make your commitment clearly known to the community that VIA does wish to become a model employer for persons with disabilities by way of honoring and celebrating the 25th anniversary of the Americans with Disabilities Act. So that's the whole intent of it, and I certainly stand ready to be of assistance in any way that I can. But in the few seconds that I have remaining, I did notice item 7 on the agenda, and I fully endorse and recommend to this board that you extend the contract of Star Shuttle for another 2 years. I think they have demonstrated that they have a commitment to serving the public, which is people with disabilities, and they have a training program which is designed to address the special needs and concerns of people who are visually impaired and other people with disabilities. This is very, very impressive and admirable, and we think the management has been very responsive to our recommendation. So without hesitation, I hope you will unanimously approve the extension of their contract. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Lori Sertucci.
Yes, my name is Lori Sertucci. I'd just like to thank VIA for their service, their real good service. I just want to make a comment about the cabs, since some people have been having trouble with the cabs. In the letters that y'all sent me, you said that the cab company's goal is to hire more drivers to help with the VIA pickups. But I think the problem is not the hiring, the lack of, or too many drivers. I think if they hire more drivers, these drivers are independent and they're going to pick the areas of town that they want to be in, so that no matter how many drivers are hired or trained for the VIA pickups, they're going to continue to saturate only certain areas, and other areas of town are going to be underserved. And other concerns that I address was some people like me that have been on the van for long periods of time. I got a couple of letters that state, well, if you were to take a bus from point A to point B, it would take 1 hour, 53 minutes, 7 seconds, and whatever. And my complaint is not on bus service, it's the VIA Trans. So when you compare with the bus, you're confused by saying that it will take a bus X amount of time to get to one point to another point when you're talking about VIA Trans. And maybe that's, if it does take 1 hour, 53 minutes, and 7 seconds from point A to point B on a city bus, maybe you need to look at that route, because maybe that's why, maybe that route has low ridership because people don't want to spend that much time on a bus. And I had a friend that was picked up yesterday at 4:45 from the lighthouse, and he said he was mad because he got home at 6:45, and he lives on medical, and he has the same Star Shuttle driver. So I guess it would take him 2 hours, 33 minutes, and 6 seconds to get home on the city bus. And that's all. And thank you.
Thank you very much.
Ferris Hodge.
I had a hard time getting over here today because I was at the Brady Green. Although my doctor, she's top, and I'm going to tell Mr. Hernandez that she's doing an outstanding job. But they have so many people at the Brady Green, I sit there 3.5 hours, you know, and started eating and stuff like that. But anyway, I made it by a wing and a prayer. Now, I had wrote a letter for about the CEO of Via, how much money do he make in benefits, and I don't think I received anything from you yet, but I'm sure I will later on. But now, let's get down to the nitty gritty. This past week, Fiesta, Via did not have a time schedule for the bus drivers. They were running side by side, they were running a race, 2-4s in the side of each other, 2-3s or whatever. And people was ticked off. So I said, got out of town, I said to the supervisor, I said, what time is my bus coming? He said, we don't have no schedule. I said, I've been riding the bus about 60 years. We always had a schedule. So I don't know who's coming up with all these crazy ideas, but y'all need to get it together. We depend on when these buses come and go. Now, y'all had plenty of supervisors at Travis Park, which y'all really needed, and they helped the people. But something's wrong with VIA when they want to change things. Now, Rosie Park, they had a something for her on the buses. And y'all, I know y'all getting ready to make new buses, so y'all need to keep what they say about Rosie Park. She was the one who refused to give up her seat to a white man, and that started the civil rights movement going. So we need to keep that up. And a lot of visitors, they come here, and they say, oh, Rosie Park, she's the one that was with the civil rights movement. So I don't know what VIA is going to do, but y'all need to, when you get the new buses. Now, y'all's buses, they leak water. The Primo buses leak water, and then you're slipping and sliding. VIA's buses smell like a sewer. I got on one of your buses today. Y'all need to change all those vents. And y'all need to buy some kind of spray. Some of the drivers, they buy their own spray. And they put everybody off the bus, and they spray the bus, and then let them back on. Because every time it rains, and then the buses leak. Water coming down on people. I almost slipped the other day. I told that driver, I said, wait a minute, man. I'm 61 going on 62. I'm about to fall and break a leg, and then I'm going to own VIA. Well, man, I'm in a hurry. I said, you're not in that big a hurry. You stop this bus and let us sit down. Another lady almost fell. I grabbed her by the arm, and she said if she had busted her knee open, she would own VIA. I don't care how late these buses are. They have to slow down and let us hold to something. The hydrant buses, y'all need to put more of them on the Primo route because y'all have too many of the Primo buses breaking down. So you are my sunshine, my only sunshine. Okay, I'm running out of time. But anyway, I had a hard time getting here, but I was over at Brady Green, and I was saying a little prayer that I would get here on time, and I barely made it.
Janet,
but, always wants to come here, and y'all have a good day. Y'all smile a little bit. There you go. Y'all look better now.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Have a good day.
Thank you.
Y'all my family.
Good afternoon. My name is Janet Denisi, and I'm the business office manager for Watercrest at Alamo Ranch. And it's a retirement community for it's independent living for 55 and above. We just opened up at the beginning of the year in January, and we're expected to house more than 200 senior citizens and geriatric population. We do have a couple of buses that we run them to appointments and things like that on. Many of them, though, are widowed. They don't have any children or family at all in town, and they really are lacking some transportation. I have called twice and made two tickets or issue numbers to see if they could possibly service them somehow. That's their only means sometimes and their only vice to be able to get out and go other places aside from the normal trips that we take them on. So it's a really big concern, and you know, coming here today as your advocate, I'd really like for you all to kind of open your eyes and see what can be done. The tickets that I've opened in the past, they've said that they don't know quite sure when it's going to be annexed or when we're going to be part of the bus lines. But knowing that there's going to be so many more people, you know, living there, it's really, really important to us, really, really passionate about making sure that they do get a ride where they do need to go. And so that's why I'm here today, to see what can be done or if it can be addressed. I've never ridden the bus in probably 20 years, and I did to the Luminaris Festival, and it was superb. It was wonderful. It was very shocking to me how well organized and everything that it was, and I had a really good experience. And knowing some of the residents who live with us, I just know that they would greatly appreciate, you know, your services out there. They're ready to stand and do a picket line if they have to and call the news, because they really, really need the service. So whatever you can do, and if I can leave my information perhaps or my business card with somebody to get a hold of me, it would be really appreciated. Again, I'm here to be their voice, as many of them cannot be here. So I appreciate y'all's time today, and keep up the good work, and hopefully I'll hear from one of y'all soon so that we can see what can be done for our residents.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Martha Oliver.
My name is Martha Oliver, and I represent SADA, San Antonio Area Disability Advocates. We have a contract also with Star Shuttle to do training with their new drivers coming on board. And we really like to do that because we make them feel more at ease. They learn that we use the same language, the same dictionary that they do. When you have a person with visual impairments and you're picking them up tomorrow, it's okay to say, I'll see you tomorrow. I mean, you don't have to make up another word for I'll see you tomorrow. Or if I'm in the chair, as I always am, they can say, oh, you're going to go that far? You're going to walk that far? Well, yeah, I'm going to ride, but it's okay. The word is walk. So I truly enjoy doing the sessions and hope that we can continue the relationship we have with Star Shuttle. We are not doing it with VIA, but we are with Star Shuttle. The other thing is we have a lot of problems, as any company would have, with as many riders as you guys have. And so we need to have perhaps a session where we can discuss those things and have them documented on paper. We can't bring them here to you because there's nothing that you can do. You don't have anything concrete in your hand to look into. So if we want to be complaining and doing those kind of things, then we need to write them. I know Mr. Frost probably runs the other way when he sees me, because if I have something to say, I have it written down on a piece of paper already for him to read and look into, with agent names, times, dates, and the incident as I see it. It may be a different incident from the driver's point of view, but that's how I see it. And so I always ask for an answer in writing, and I always get one. So if the rest of us want to do that and want to complain, then that's how it should be done, because there's no way that all of you can see into it at one time. So I hope we continue to have a good relationship with Star Shuttle, maybe start one with VIA in the future. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Madam Chairwoman, there are no more citizens to be heard.
Thank you very much. Let the record reflect that Secretary Harrison has joined us.
Yes.
And Trustee Thompson, thank you all so much. Would you like to make any welcoming comments or anything?
As always, I'm happy to be here and seeing the citizens to be heard, and knowing that the trust of us governing the Metropolitan Transit Authority, we do appreciate it, and I do feel welcome, and I hope all of you are as well.
Thank you.
And Trustee Pettis is absent this evening. And Jeff, you had an announcement?
I had one more announcement, and that is that, and it's really great that we have so many ViaTrans folks here tonight, because we're recognizing a ViaTrans operator, a van operator. Jesse Rodriguez, stand up. Jesse participated in the state rodeo in Dallas. As a van operator, he took third place. He's been a van operator since 2002, and he's participated in 7 rodeos, and he's placed in the top 3 for 4 of those competitions. So congratulations, Jesse. You see all the people you serve here, and we're very happy that you're here. Thank you.
All right, moving on to agenda item number 5, which is our consent agenda. Do we have a motion for approval for consent agenda items 5A through 5N?
So moved.
Have a second? So Trustee Sedillo did the second, and who? Trustee Ponick made the motion. All in favor, do we have any questions, any comments? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed nay. Motion carries. Thank you all. All right, moving on to agenda item number 6, fair equity analysis thresholds.
Good evening. I'm going to do a brief presentation on proposed disparate fare policy impact wording to be added to VIA's fare policy. VIA's fare policy needs to be updated to include a minority and low-income disparate impact policy as required by the Federal Transit Agency guidelines, Federal Transit Administration. Transit providers, per the relevant circular regarding Title VI requirements, must develop a policy to measure whether minority and low-income riders bear a disproportionate share of a proposed fare change. And I want to mention that there are no fare changes being proposed here. There's no changes to policy being proposed other than to add the required wording to address Title VI requirements. The transit provider shall involve the public in developing the measurement process. We, in fact, did this. VIA held a public hearing on April 23rd, 2015. The public hearing was attended by one individual other than those people hosting the hearing. Objections to the proposed policy, there were none. Feedback and comments received by the public. An individual did request that he be given a copy of the fare multipliers included in VIA's fare policy. He was told that those would be made available to him and that they have been in VIA's fare policy for years.
I'm trouble navigating my slides here. Okay, here we go. All right, so the proposed disparate impact test is that for minorities, you compare the percentage change in their average fare to that of non-minorities. If the difference in the change is less than 5 percentage points, VIA will consider there to be no disparate impact between the groups. For low-income riders, use the same threshold for the test. And if there is a disproportionate impact to minorities or low-income riders, other fare options must be examined. The rationale for the proposed test threshold is noted on this slide. The 5 percentage point difference is deemed to be fair and reasonable and appropriate to meet Title VI requirements. At current fare levels, the test threshold ensures that the impact is no more than approximately 5 cents, since VIA's current average fare levels per linked trip are just over $1. Also, this magnitude of difference is consistent with how VIA sets fares, since fares, other than for half-price transfers, are set in multiples of 5 cents. It's also important to note that small differences in calculated average fares may be the result of randomness in the sampling process. Therefore, basing decisions on differences of only a few cents may not be meaningful. And then finally, we did look at the policies of other agencies when we were crafting this policy. So here's a couple examples that I'll present to hopefully shed some light on how the test is actually implemented in practice. Test example one, let's assume that the average minority fare goes from $1 to $1.10 with a proposed fare change. This is a 10% increase. Furthermore, let's assume that the average non-minority fare goes from $1 to $1.04 with a proposed fare change. This would be a 4% increase. And so the conclusion would be that since the impact on minorities is 6 percentage points higher than on non-minorities based on the 10 minus 4, there is a disparate impact. A finding of no disparate impact would require a percentage point difference of less than 5. And I want to mention we're only using these figures for illustration. So on the next example, example two, let's again assume that the average minority fare goes from $1 to $1.10. That's a 10% increase. Assume that the average non-minority fare goes from $1 to $1.08 in this example with a proposed fare change. This would be an 8% increase. And since the impact on minorities is 2 percentage points higher than on non-minorities based on 10 minus 8, there is no disparate impact in this example since the percentage point difference is less than 5. And so, in conclude, making a few concluding remarks, I want to mention that the proposed change, again, to FIA's fare policy is simply to add required disparate impact policy wording to address Title VI requirements. The proposed test threshold is 5 percentage points for the reasons that have been presented. And then finally, I want to mention that FIA's fare policy already has a built-in mechanism for helping to prevent a disparate impact from occurring, since it includes fare multipliers used to address fares. So for instance, when a base fare change, when there's a change in the base fare, other fare changes move in concert with that based on specified relationships between those fares and the base fare. And with that, glad to address any questions or comments that you may have regarding the proposed policy wording.
Members, any questions or comments?
Madam Chair, this proposal came through our operations committee, and I want to note just one point, which is that although the 5 percentage point standard is one that we've internally come up with, which we think is sensible, it is lower than what Dallas has and what Houston has. I think Dallas has a 10 percentage point standard, and Houston had a 20 percentage point standard. So ours, as I understood it, was rather conservative and small, which is good news for purposes of making sure that we don't have a disparate impact in our fee structure. Am I right on that, Steve?
Well, you know, technically, I would just like to point out that the Houston, Cap Metro, and Dallas policies, they have different percents, but it also appears, based on the wording, they're assessed in a little bit different way, so it's not strictly an apples-to-apples comparison. But certainly our policy is very conservative and keeps that difference very small.
Trustee Gambino, did you have a question?
I did. I think it would behoove us to explain a little more clearly how there could be a disparate impact at all among fares. I know that where there's zones and with different fares between different zones, or within perhaps could you explain how that could come about where there would be a different impact upon minorities than non-minorities?
For example, if you had a change to a base fare where you were impacting your cash-paying customers very strongly, you could have a disparate impact. For instance, the cash-paying customers tend to be, if you look at the low-income group, they tend to use cash more so than other groups, and so they don't buy the monthly passes, they'll pay the daily fares. And so if you had that fare impacted and then your pass fares didn't follow in tandem with that, you could have a disparate impact. But again, we have a policy that has the pass fares move when the base fare moves.
Right. Okay.
Any questions or comments from this side? Trustee Ponick, I'm sorry, Trustee Martin?
No, I would just move that we adopt this policy.
Okay.
Second.
So we have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed nay. Motion passes. Thank you very much. Moving on to agenda item number 7, contract extension via Trans Transportation Services. Ms. Carrasco?
Good evening, Madam Chair, board members. The purpose of this item tonight is to request the approval of a 2-year contract extension with Star Shuttle for ViaTrans Transportation Services. Since the inception of ViaTrans service in 1980, private sector transportation contractors have provided service in conjunction with Via's own directly operated service. Via provides scheduling and reservations of all trips, direct and contracted. Star Shuttle has been a provider of paratransit services for us approximately 20 years. Currently, they operate a fleet of approximately 150 vehicles with 257 van operators. Star Shuttle provides about 58% of ViaTrans services. Back in June 2012, the Board of Trustees approved a three-year contract to Star Shuttle. The contract took effect January 2013 and is due to expire at the end of this year in December. An extension option was included for an additional 2 years. If approved, the term will take effect on January 1st, 2016. Staff evaluated Star Shuttle's performance in the last 2 years and concluded service meets our contract standards. As part of Star Shuttle's new terms for the contract extension, Star Shuttle agrees to provide 80 new minivans and 20 new accessible vehicles by January of 2016. Also, they agreed to provide a new minimum hourly rate, wage rate, to their van operators. Their current rate is, they start at $8.71 and top off at $10.25. Their new rate will go up 16% approximately. The new rate is $10.10 to start to $11.60 per hour. We anticipate the wage rate increase will improve productivity and performance by reducing their turnover rate. Following extensive discussions over a period of several months, a proposed new contract rate of $38.88 per hour was mutually agreed upon, with the term changes, of course, and the new rate of $38.88. This is an 8.9% increase over the current rate of $35.71. The cost increase will mostly cover wage increases for van operators. VIA's internal audit department performed a cost analysis of Star Shuttle operating expenses and verified the basis for the proposed rate. Our recommendation is that the Board of Trustees authorize the President CEO to execute the 2-year extension with Star Shuttle for an amount not to exceed $27 million. The proposed contract rate of $38.88 per service hour will result in an annual increase of approximately $1 million over our fiscal year 2015 budget. This is a DOT-assisted project with an assigned overall DBE goal of 21%. Currently, we have exceeded that goal with an achievement of 71%. Mr. John Walker, President CEO of Star Shuttle, is present with us tonight, and he would like to come up and address the board at this time.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Madam Chairman and members of the Board of Trustees,
VIA management and staff, VIA Trans clients that are here tonight, and ladies and gentlemen, as Alva said, my name is John Walker. I'm CEO of Star Shuttle. We are proud of and thankful for our 23-year relationship with VIA. VIA Trans service is a very special service with unique requirements and challenges. It's a calling, if you will. Daily, we work side by side with VIA Trans Guide and at our offices to ensure the very best possible service. Our relationship has always been professional, positive, and cooperative, doing whatever it takes to get the job done. Please note that three members of our senior management staff that would be here tonight are in Atlanta tonight at the annual FTA Drug and Alcohol National Training Program, which is something that we attend each year. Furman Gaitan, one of our operations managers for paratransit, is here, and Amy McCallick, our accounting manager, came as well in case there's any questions, and I would like them just to stand and say hello. During the last several months, we've implemented a number of enhancements and improvements to improve safety, productivity, and on-time performance. First of all, we reorganized our safety and training program by hiring a new director of risk, safety, and training. This individual is licensed in both risk management and also has been a licensed insurance adjuster. We moved training from operations to direct oversight by the new director of training. And we also extended our contract with San Antonio Area Disability Advocates and the Alamo Council of the Blind. These are very important relationships and have had a very positive impact, not only on our operators because they get firsthand knowledge, but also it's a very good experience, and it helps the organizations as well. The second thing we did is we implemented an accident reduction program, including post-accident driver retraining. We established a safety review board that meets with drivers who have had preventable accidents to discuss accident factors and to ensure that they won't have future accidents. We've also placed more emphasis on assisting ambulatory clients. This is an area of we're seeing more and more very elderly clients that have a hard time walking. And so we're trying to identify clients and work with VIA when people get to the point where they really can't get from the van to a health appointment or wherever they're going. We've instituted more on-the-road training. We've continued our drive cam video coaching. We've implemented new safety awards to recognize accident-free drivers. And finally, we've been working with VIA, looking at how accidents happen in additional ways to improve our safety program. We've also improved recruiting. We've hired full-time experienced recruiter to generate more quality drivers. We've hired two additional trainers. We started doing job fairs at Texas Workforce. We've implemented a computerized application process and tracking, expedited our application to hire process, implemented an employee referral bonus, and with our new facilities and trainers, we now start a new training class every Monday and have up to three classes going on at one time. Next, we are completing the move of all our personnel to our new facilities. Our new facilities include a new 4.2-acre campus, ideally located for VIA Trans service. We're two blocks from the intersection of Loop 410 and Airport Boulevard. We have direct access to 281 and Loop 410. We have 20,000 square feet of remodeled office and shop space, all designed for the delivery of VIA Trans service. It represents about a $3.5 million investment, including new security gates, lighting, fencing, and security cameras. We've also tried to reduce turnover and improve driver retention. And one part of that, an important aspect, is that even though the rate increase is approximately 8.9%, the initial driver pay is increasing 16%, and it's the bulk of the increase that we are receiving if approved tonight. We have a little handout just to kind of you can see some of the things that we've been doing for the drivers. We have a new break room, new TV room, new quiet room, outside picnic areas, a new continuing education room. We're offering more flexible schedules. We now have a new wellness program, and of course we have many company-sponsored events. Finally, we've implemented new programs to improve on-time performance and productivity by having supervisors and managers actually spend more time one-on-one with drivers that need continuing education and need a little bit of assistance in areas such as improving their map reading skills, safe driving skills, and customer service skills. This is just a snapshot of what we're doing to constantly improve the ViaTrans service. We appreciate this opportunity. We look forward to continue to work with Via, and I'll be glad to answer any questions that you may have. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Walker. Members, any questions for Mr. Walker?
Please.
Okay.
I'm glad to hear that you're growing. I'd like to know, how many drivers do you have at this time?
Paratransit drivers?
Mm-hmm.
It would be full and part-time around 250.
250. And is Via the only contract that you have?
No.
No. Okay. Thank you.
Another question I have, Mr. Walker. The outside... you use an outside organization for your background checks and things of that nature, correct?
Yes.
Okay, you are still employing them, yes?
Yes, of course, yes. We run a background check on every applicant.
That's correct, but you use a firm, an outside firm, to do so?
Yes.
Okay. Another question I have is that you're using all caravans now? You're going away from the larger vehicles, or?
It's a combination of caravans that have been upfitted for wheelchairs, and then the large vans. We run 30 large vans, are the green Glovell vehicles.
Right. Now, are they all equipped with drive cam?
Yes.
Okay. That's all I have.
Thank you.
Trustee Ponick?
Yes, Madam Chair. This item also came through my committee. You know, it under the circumstances and with the history that we've had in terms, again, of our funding and the need that we have to meet with this particular community of our customers, it's essential for us to have some kind of partnership with a reliable third party, and our history with Star Shuttle has been fairly positive, and staff reports that, you know, the negotiated rate that we have today is even better than the next lowest rate that was offered to us 3 years ago when we first considered getting into a contract or a new contract with this company. There's obviously going to be a difference between what service we're able to provide, and the retention rate that we enjoy is very, very good. That's one of the challenges in comparison that your company is met with. So I would just encourage you to do everything you can to encourage employee retention, because I think one of the things that we hear about Via and how great our service is that people know the customers, they've seen them for years, and I think that just makes the customer that much more comfortable with the service they're getting. So if there would be one message that I would encourage you to take with you and to continue to do in every way you can, is to make sure that your employees want to continue to be your employees and provide that kind of service.
Very good. Thank you.
Okay. Any comments? You know, Mr. Walker, I concur with Trustee Ponick. I am concerned with you've got high turnover. One of the things that's very important for us, of course, is customer service. And just want to remind you that these are our riders, and they're special.
Right. I agree.
And so we want to make sure that that you provide the best service that you can. But you certainly have enjoyed a partnership with VIA for many years, and so we look forward to working together with you. And please feel free to reach out to us if you need any assistance. I know we talked at our committee meeting about any training that we may be able to help you with. We just want to make sure that it's a seamless operation and that we continue providing the great service that our riders deserve.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So, Trustee Ponick, do we have a motion?
So moved.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Okay. We have a motion and a second. Any further questions or comments? All in favor say aye.
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 All opposed nay. Motion carries. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Moving on to agenda item number 8, San Antonio B-Cycle Bike Share Program. Mr. Buchanan.
Good evening, Madam Chair and members of the board. This evening, I'd just like to bring an informational item to the board. You may have heard some recent discussions over the last month or so about San Antonio B-Cycle and some of their funding challenges here in San Antonio. So we just wanted to bring forward how B-Cycle integrates with our multimodal transportation options here in San Antonio and show how they are really integrated into our service and how VIA and B-Cycle work together. A little bit about B-Cycle. They started in 2011 here in the San Antonio region. They have about 55 bike stations downtown along the river, mainly concentrated in the urban core, urban district. They also help us offer that last mile of travel and options for our riders. Most of their stations occur near bus stops, so that's good for us and good for them also. We do provide them a financial sponsorship of $7,500 a year. As a map sponsor, we have our logo printed on their maps on their system. And most bike stops, as I mentioned earlier, are within the proximity of a multitude of routes, some of our major stops also. B-Cycle's usage over the years has continued to grow. As you can see here, every month, B-Cycle is growing and moving forward. They continue to grow and add stations associated with that. And a lot of their growth here, and I'll show you in a minute, occurs along the Mission Reach, a lot of their bike share mobility options. Their busiest bike share location where the check-ins and check-outs occur, Blue Star area, obviously getting down to the river and riding along the river. Alamo Plaza, Hemisphere Park, Main Plaza, urban areas, a lot of ridership and a lot of also integrated with our bus stops in those areas. There is a potential TxDOT grant that is out there that kind of generated some of the conversation as occurring over the last month, that they would like to expand the system from, could expand the system from 55 stations to a total of 76 stations and obviously increase the amount of bikes that are put out there. Obviously, with the increase in capital, there comes an increase in operating costs, and they are obviously fundraising to try to incur those costs. I will tell you the conversation in the community seems to be pretty positive that B-Cycle is very important to this community, and I just want to make that recommendation here also. It's very important to us in providing multimodal transportation options here in San Antonio. So how are we working together? We're here today to just continue to tell you and update you that we want to continue to be a partner with B-Cycle through our MAP sponsorship. We will continue that yearly obligation as we move forward. We'll continue with our system planning as we build out new capital projects such as Central Plaza, our Five Points bus expansion and bus stop area expansions. We continue to look for opportunities for B-Cycle to be integrated into our VIA infrastructure. And we'll definitely continue to talk to them about being that last mile connection and just giving people here in this community a different modes of transportation as choices here in the community. So with that, I'd be happy to answer any questions about B-Cycle or any of the conversation that's going on in the community over the last month or so.
Trustee Morgan, did you?
Yes. Actually, Brian, I'd like to update you. I did get the chance to meet with Cindy Snell, who is the director of B-Cycle.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay. I got the opportunity to meet with Cindy Snell, who is the director over at B-Cycle, and she's very interested in working with VIA. I think we should definitely, I would urge staff to explore a wider partnership with them. I think there's a very big opportunity to solve problems for them and for us. And I think it's very easy for us both to come out with a very big win here. She's more than happy to reach out to you guys and sit down and talk. And I'd love to connect the two of you and make sure that that happens and we can go forward with this and make it a bigger part of what VIA does so that we can get our writers where they need to go, how they want to get there. Additionally, she also let me know that currently the B-cycle bicycles do not fit within our
bike racks.
Part of what they're also going to be spending some of their capital is changing out their fleet into bikes that do fit on our buses so that people can go greater distances and utilize both of our services.
Thank you. Any comments from this side?
I would just like to reiterate that the $7,500 participation could be tenfold, and we spend $7,500 on buttons or on t-shirts, and this is something that I think is a better interface with the community and is truly multimodal. And if that's what we profess to be, then we should walk this walk, and we should buy more than just $7,500 shoes to walk that walk. So anything that we can do to increase that participation, I think would be appreciated by the entire community.
And I also would like to second Trustee Marn's comments that when staff and B-Cycle meet is that we really need to explore potential possibilities of helping them, you know, quite bluntly with their operating costs.
Sure.
Because I look at it's an investment in the community and it's a great opportunity for us to lead the way. So when we have those meetings, I think we should seriously consider that.
Secretary, did you have a...
Oh, yeah, I was just on a technical point. I know that we're going to, and I brought this up before, the smart meter that we're using for the actual bus cards. Mm-hmm. Now, I know that our system could actually probably support 4 items. I think B-Cycle could be integrated into our bus cards. That would be something that would be kind of a seamless transition. They're using their bus cards for getting on the bus. They can use the bus card to rent a bike.
Any other comments? I will tell you that I think you've heard from the board that we're excited and we're supportive, and I think this could possibly set us on the path of being multimodal. So I encourage you to keep exploring it.
Yeah, that's great to hear, and staff will take that back. And I will tell you that at about 5:10 this afternoon, I received a text message from the city of San Antonio about the meeting. So we will move forward with talking to them about those relationships.
Great. Thank you very much. All right, moving on to agenda item number 9, Tiger Grant update. Mr. Buchanan.
Yes, I get to take you all the way to 9:30 for the Spurs game, so.
We're going to make it.
So good evening once again. This evening I'd like to discuss with you the Tiger program. The Tiger program is the transportation and investment generating economic recovery. They've done this almost every single year over the last several years as the economic recovery of the nation moves forward in moving infrastructure projects through the system and getting people to work out there. This time, their call for projects, it is competitive. I will tell you that this is always oversubscribed by 100-fold of the amount of needs that are out there for infrastructure, as many of you know. But this call is for $500 million. Be appropriated through September 30th. On May 4th, you must submit about a 100-word synopsis of your project and then have final applications in on June 5th, 2015. The types of projects that they are looking for associated with the Tiger program have primary and secondary criteria. The primary criteria is always to maintain your system in a state of good repair. Make sure the projects are economically competitive. They add to the quality of life in the community, help with the environmental sustainability and continue the sustainability of the community, and obviously improve safety. some secondary things that have come over the last several years with the grant applications are innovation. Are you innovatively putting people to work? Are you innovatively partnering with others on innovative projects? And partnerships are huge. These projects that tend to be awarded tend to be partnerships of communities. Communities all get together and submit a community project, not individual projects from each individual entity inside a community. So those that have been successful have submitted one community project. And they need to be ready. The whole investment here is to put people to work and put the economy back out up there. And putting people to work and having a project ready is important. Also, they tend to look at the project's funding, make sure you're not displacing other funding with this funding. So these are projects that would not be funded or would not be capable of being constructed or put into service were not for the Tiger funding. I mentioned the match. Most traditional federal funds are 80-20 type conversations with the federal government. These are more like 50-50 conversations as we're moving forward. They need to be ready with the project, and they must tell a good story and a project impact. These are projects that make great community impacts. So I'm going to show you an example of the ones that we have submitted through the years, and I think you'll agree that these are community-changing projects. First and foremost, in 2011, we submitted a Tiger grant for Central Plaza, the project that is under construction today. We were awarded a $15 million Tiger grant for that project. That is about the construction cost of that project out there in September. We also, in 2012, submitted the Robert Thompson Transit Center. We were not awarded, but we have moved that project forward with finding other funding moving forward. In 2013, we submitted the 281 Park and Ride. That was kind of the next project out of the capital program that was ready. We were not awarded that that contract or that award, but we did find other ways to fund that project through the capital program. And in 2014, we probably submitted the best Tiger grant application that I've seen for the modern streetcar project, and I will not discuss how that ended, but it was a great, I think everybody here has gotten some informal and formal debriefs, and that was a great application, and I think we should all be proud of the application we put in on the modern streetcar project.
It was posted, it's posted on your slide that it was not awarded. Did it get to the point where a decision was made to award, or did we pull that back beforehand?
We didn't actually pull the application, but it was not awarded. They just did not award us that. I don't know why they didn't award it, but we could assume maybe why they did not award us the contract. Yeah,
there's just a tension with the next statement that you're about to make.
Yeah. So I think through the years, I mentioned that communities that tend to get these types of Tiger grants tend to submit one application. And over the multitude of years, all those I just showed you, those last 4 years, the community has stepped aside for VIA. VIA has been the only applicant that has applied for the Tiger grants. There are other projects in the community that are being talked about. The City of San Antonio has discussed two projects with a multitude of partners that they would like to pursue Tiger grants for this year. So VIA, our staff, is recommending at this time that we, this year, in this Tiger grant round, step aside and allow another entity to submit a Tiger application, and we would support that application with letters of support and possible financial support yet to be determined. I do not have any of those answers here today, but we would not submit a Tiger grant application for this go-around of funding and allow some others to submit. So with that, I'd be happy to answer any questions about our recommendation on the Tiger grant funding this year.
Members, any questions?
Thank you for the presentation. Do you know if the projects that the city are considering are in the promise zone or the hub zone area? Because, you know, we get extra points for it.
Right. The one project they're looking at is right adjacent to the Promise Zone. It is the Broadway corridor. It's improvements in the Broadway corridor. And doesn't quite go into the Promise Zone, but it's adjacent to the Promise Zone.
Okay. I'll have to say that I'm a little disappointed that we're not looking at the Thompson center again, because I think that was an opportunity back in 2012, and I know the Promise Zone was not established back then. The Promise Neighborhood was, and that was outside of the neighborhood, but now with the zone and the hub zone opportunities, that would really, as you had in your presentation, really enhance and redevelop that whole community. So I think it's a missed opportunity for VIA.
Understood.
Any other questions?
I see a reason for staff's recommendation and support that recommendation of not moving forward this year. Although the tension that I mentioned before, it was the case, I think, that the people of this city lost $20 to $40 million in a Tiger Grant last time by having the support, which was once there for our application, wither away rather quickly during that time. So I just wanted to say that, but I do support and understand fully why VIA might not put in this particular time.
Thank you. Thank you. Moving on to agenda item number 10, Central Plaza Plan.
So this evening I'd like to speak a little bit about the Tiger Grant we received, the Central Plaza Plan. I will tell you that construction is moving along very well out there. We tend to talk in terms of rain, and it has been a little rainy here recently, but things are moving forward. This is a graphic of kind of where we're planning to go, and based on what I see out there today, the graphic looks pretty well representative of what's going on out there. But I wanted to take you back a little bit to talk a little bit about the vision, the idea, the concept, our investment that would catalyze other investment in this particular area. And this is the grand area. Here's Central Plaza and the construction. You can see it is a major, major footprint in this community. But as we move forward with multimodalism and different modes of transportation here in San Antonio, this has the opportunity to become the multimodal hub of San Antonio. In the back here are two different types of rail projects, one being the Lone Star Rail commuter rail project up to Austin, and the project and the location of also for the San Antonio stop for the high-speed rail program, if that was to move forward, would also occur at this location here over at Westside Multimodal Center. So there's a multitude of different rail options there adjacent to the railroad. There's also an opportunity for over-the-road type buses, Greyhound, Megabus type scenarios to be able to dock. And once again, just bringing a full plethora, a multitude of different transportation options into this area so that we can then circulate them out through the VIA system. And then you can see some of the other buildings in the area. I can tell you there's some construction and renovation occurring on this particular property right now. They're upgrading that building. I can only assume that's because of the investments we made in that area. There's construction right in this area over here associated with some new medical services in the area. And there's a lot of ongoing discussion about development in the area. There's a 250-unit, just off the screen, apartment complex that is coming into the area too. So I think the public investment is working. We're moving forward. And I think the bigger vision is important. So kind of down to the Central Plaza vision, you can see it's a very active space. It has the ability to host a series of events and not only act as a transit plaza, but as a community space and a community place. You can see the food carts, food truck ability on the plaza. This is the historic building we speak a lot about that's being renovated as part of the program of the projects. This is the corn shell building that we're going to build out and rent out and lease out for a tenant. And this is kind of our community room up in this area that would be available for rentals for board meetings or just day rentals to have community in office space associated with daily meetings and things like that. And this is about 800 square feet of community of waiting area for our passengers so they can stay out of the weather. It's a conditioned space as we move forward. The iconic image out there is not only the sweeping curves and the areas you see out there, the canopy, but there will be a light tower, and this light tower is approximately 82 feet in height, so it will be a rather significant beacon of light out in the area. It'll be wrapped with over 1 million LEDs that will change colors and be able to change different aspects and create a visual art similar to what the Robert B. Green does in the evenings. We're kind of playing off that conversation in the community. So a couple months ago, many months ago, we got the name. So we have stricken Westside Multimodal Center from the top of the Central Plaza here. And we've started to look at the name placements and the different fonts and the different ways that we can brand the area. So I'll walk you through a series of slides. Staff does not have a formal recommendation, but if the Board of Trustees would like to give me any feedback, I would greatly appreciate that. But here you can see the letterings will all be illuminated. They're about 3 feet in height. And you can see as I move forward with these, we play with the font and kind of with the size of them moving forward, and just how they make an impact to the way, the look and the feel of the plaza.
Is there an architect involved in the design of this, and do they have a recommendation?
Yeah, we will be bringing that. These are their early ideas to bring these forward, but EEK, the group that helped us work through all this, is also working with us on the signage program associated with this. So another aspect of this is we're going to build a great facility. How do we manage it on a daily basis, and how do we energize it and activate it? So staff is going through a process right now to develop an activation plan for the plaza. We are going to utilize our existing contract to get started, to write an RFP to issue in June here to call for professional management services for the plaza. VIA will manage it until opening day, around until about the first of the year, and then we will turn it over to that management company. We're looking for things similar to, if anybody's familiar with Pioneer Square in Portland, Oregon, it is a great activated space. It is basically wrapped in transit all around it, including the rail system there in Portland. But it is an active space, not only on the weekdays, but also on the weekends. And I think that's kind of the look and the feel that we're kind of going for out there at Via Villa. So the activation plan is multifaceted. It includes our security, our maintenance, our operations, our safety, our facilities, our public affairs. Basically, every division within Via touches this facility in some way moving forward. We'll look at analyzing comparable public spaces such as Pioneer Square that I mentioned, develop some benchmarks, look at things like Main Plaza, Travis Park, what has been good, what has been bad about the different ways that they've activated those plazas, and look for our leasing of that corn shell building that I mentioned, looking for a good tenant, the reliable tenant, a long worthy tenant to move into that space and to help us activate that space, whether or not that be a restaurant or some other type of activity, but just getting some daily activity on that space. So with that, I'd be happy to answer any questions about our process moving forward to activate the plaza or the graphic images associated with the naming of the facility.
Members?
Is it far enough away from the Pearl where this could be an alternate site for farmers markets and such?
We have talked about farmers markets, and I do believe they are. It is far enough away. They could be a standalone farmers market.
You know, just to reiterate what Mr. Buchanan was saying, in the United States, we are going toward a multimodal, intermodal facilities where everybody's housed in one area. Now, this is something that's going and very popular around the country because it works so well. You know, Union Station in Los Angeles, they had an old train station that's been there since the, you know, turn of the century. That has been reactivated in Los Angeles for their transit hub, and it's working very well. And New York City the same, Washington, D.C. the same. This is something that across the country has a lot of synergistic value to it. And also, when you apply for grants and things of that nature, it is a community opponent of your transit service.
I know that we have a number of artists, both glass and light, electric light, here in San Antonio. as you go further and explore options for the signage, I think it behooves us to look into the artists that we already have, that we are, have explored for other programs, and to see if there's maybe something that they might be able to do that's also intriguing with our signage.
I failed to mention the artist for the light tower is Bill Fitzgibbons. He is a local artist, and he is on this contract.
And the two will be integrated.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
That's important to mention, I think.
Thank you very much. Moving on to 10B, security and supervision.
I think we will do all of 10B will be in closed session, so we'll move to the next item and then move
into closed. Okay, all right, so then we're
session.
Going to do a legislative update. Okay.
Yes, and then we'll move into closed session for the remainder, all right. Correct.
Good evening, Madam Chair, members. President Art, I have with me from Austin this evening Mark Rodriguez, who heads our state legislative efforts in Austin, to provide you a legislative overview.
Good evening, Ms. Chair and board members. What we'd like to do in just a couple of minutes is quickly update you on what the team is working on in Austin, Texas, and also in the form of recommendations on moving forward. There's still a lot of time in session. The deadline for a Senate bill, for example, to get out of the House of Representatives is May 26th. This is the time of session where you have to step up your advocacy efforts and stay on the football field, simply put. That is why our first recommendation is to maintain a high level of advocacy on SB 1837 by Senator Menendez. The hearing was very supportive, very informative. However, there's some misinformation out there, we believe, from the opposition. However, what we need to do is re-lobby and re-advocate with each Senate committee member and also with each House committee member on the equivalent where the House bill also sits, regardless of whether it's been heard for hearing, pulled for hearing, or not. So again, stepping up the level of advocacy and staying with those efforts. Suburban cities and those elected officials and those representatives could be very crucial, and we highly recommend that the team continue to advocate with suburban cities to advocate in Austin, Texas. The enhancement legislation, we have a House and a Senate committee chairman that are not very supportive of enhancement or enhancement penalties. We've readjusted our strategy a bit to see if we can produce a new offense regarding criminal activity on public transportation property. That may be the route to go. That may get the committee chairman comfortable. We're working with the House and Senate sponsors specifically on that legislation. We continue to advocate for successful passage of SB 12 by Senator Ureste regarding alternative fuels. The last 2 weeks we had to make sure that the language was correct, that transit authorities, public transit authorities, were included in the bill. That took a little bit of work. We had to be sure that we were included in the bill. I'm assuming all of this is coordinated with Shauna Russell in Austin, Texas, and here in San Antonio. We want to maintain our opposition to at least three design-build bills that would directly affect VIA's authority on this type of operation. They come up every session. We've been successful the last two sessions in cementing that authority for VIA. I do not believe they're going to be successful. However, we're watching them very, very closely regarding design-build legislation. We maintain our advocacy efforts on HB 1324 by Celia Israel from Austin, Texas, regarding the buses on shoulders pilot program. That still needs some work, still needs some pushing and some advocating, but we're also on that effort. There have not been major revenue pieces of legislation affecting VIA's financial authority. However, this is the part of session where amendments pop up literally at the 11th hour at 11 p.m. So the team is always on the field. If the House is in session, we're in session. If the Senate's in session, we're in session also. Thank you very much. questions.
Members, any questions? No? Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
The time is now 6:37 p.m. and the Via Metropolitan Transit Board of Trustees will officially go into a closed executive session. The items we will discuss during this executive session are as follows. Item 10B, entitled Central Plaza Plan B, Security and Supervision, which is an executive session item pursuant to the Texas Government Code, Section 551.071, entitled Consultation with Attorney, and Section 551.076, entitled Security. And item 11, entitled Legislative Update, which is an executive session item pursuant to the Texas Government Code, Section 551.071, entitled Consultation with Attorney. And item 12A, entitled Legal Briefing, A, Parking Initiatives, Tobin Garage Parking Agreement, which is an executive session item pursuant to the Texas Government Code, Section 551.071, entitled Consultation with Attorney. All persons who are authorized to attend the executive session, please go directly to the small conference room. It is now 7:04 p.m. and we're officially coming out of a closed executive session regarding agenda items 10B, 11, 12A. No deliberations of public policy or vote taking occur during this executive session. So, moving on to agenda item number 13. Do we have a motion for adjournment of the regular VIA board meeting?
Motion.
We have a motion and a second. Would anybody like to comment or have any questions on it? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay. VIA board meeting is officially adjourned. Where's my English level? Okay, thank you. All right, I hereby now call the Advanced Transportation District regular board meeting of April 28th to order. We will go into agenda item number 3. Do we have a motion to for approval of the consent agenda?
So moved.
Motion.
We have a motion and a second. Okay. Any questions, comments? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. Motion carries. All right, at this time, the time is now 7:05 p.m., and the Advanced Transportation District Board of Trustees will officially go into a closed executive session. The items that we will discuss during this executive session are as follows. Item 4, entitled ATD County TxDOT Funding Options and Agreements for Transportation and Infrastructure, which is an executive session item pursuant to the Texas Government Code, Section 551.071, entitled Consultation with Attorney. And item number 5, entitled Legal Briefing, which is an executive session item pursuant to the Texas Government Code, Section 551.071, entitled Consultation with Attorney. All persons who are authorized to attend this executive session, please proceed to the small conference room. All right, it is now 7:31 p.m., and we're officially coming out of a closed executive session regarding agenda items 4 and 5. No deliberations of public policy or vote taking occurred during this executive session. So I believe that we are now down to agenda item number 6. But before we go on to agenda item number 6, President Arndt, I have a couple of acknowledgments that I'd like to make.
Sure.
You know, I have to tell you that I've been on the board now for 90 days or 90 days. And I'm telling you that I'm having a great time. There is a lot of excitement in the air. As a matter of fact, the last time that I met with the president, I sent him a text that evening, and I said, there's a lot of excitement in the air about all that VIA is doing, and I'm proud to be part of it, and look forward to many more celebrations as we've been having. But also, you as board members take time from your busy schedules to participate in so many events, and I just want to say thank you. Thank you to each one of you. Dr. Gambita, Mr. Trustee Bryant, you certainly helped us launching the e-pilot program with our Cascaron Christening on March 28th. It was great to see you all there. Vice Chairman Allison, and again, Trustee Bryant, you welcomed the VTAC members and participated in the group's kickoff meeting on April 8th. Thank you so much. And again, Vice Chairman Allison, Trustee Bryant, and Trustee Cedillo, you represented VIA at a community reception honoring TxDOT Commissioner Bruce Bug earlier this month. I hear it was a very successful event. But you know, your presence there makes such a difference, because what they're seeing is that VIA is there. And again, Mr. Bryan, Mr. Harrison, you attended the SA Tomorrow kickoff on April 11th. Mr. Allison has been our rock star in Austin, testifying and wrote an opinion piece related to the current proposed state legislation that was printed in the newspaper. I had so many positive feedback on that. Thank you so much for doing that. And again, Trustee Cedillo and Trustee Bryant, you recently served as VIA celebrity judges for the agency's annual youth art contest. And finally, Trustee Harrison, you and your family led us in showcasing the e-trolley at the King William Parade and Fair last Saturday. Thank you to all of you for being such a great board member, and you know, your attendance at these events and leading these efforts certainly puts VIA out there in the community. So I just wanted to say, as your chair, I'm very proud to be working alongside you all. Thank you so much. Do I have a motion for adjournment?
Motion.
Second. Okay, we have a motion and a second. Anyone would like to question that or make any comment on that adjournment?
Go Spurs, go.
All right. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Okay. Oh. Meeting is adjourned. Oh.
Would also like to say that we love being our chair. There you go. And happy anniversary.
Thank you. Thank you. And I have to tell you that, you know, I've had gavels before and they've been large, and I thought, wait a minute, did somebody change out my gavel? But I kind of now, I think Trustee Thompson said it's smaller, it's ladylike, and I do like it. It's feminine. I'm going to call it mine. I like it.
And it's still loud.